afternoon.
Howdy.
Howdy, yes. I want to thank especially the students for this generous invitation and for participating in what's very important in terms of our formation as academics and as scholars within society. Special hats off to Naheed and to faculty members Fred and Ivana for your part in making this happen, and to Julia, who generously picked me up at the airport. I was thinking about Texas, and even the welcomes are big here, so thank you for that big welcome. I think before I get started, I should clarify a few things. Of course, I'm from Canada. That's the first thing. We do say A, that is correct. You can use that one. It's pronounced Regina for some reason. That is beyond my understanding. And no, we don't live in igloos, although I have slept in a quinsy, which is, for those of you who don't know, you pile a bunch of snow and carve it out, and you can sleep in it. And I've slept in one in over minus 20 Celsius outside. And as a tip, if you do sleep in a quinsy, you should make sure to pee before you get in, because it's not pleasant to get out of them. The other thing I want to raise your attention to is you have a wonderful faculty here. If you're a grad student in the audience, listen to them. They're so caring. I'm very touched by how caring. It's noteworthy, and I want to bring that to your attention. You have a wonderful environment for learning, for mentoring, and for becoming all that you can be. This may sound cliche, but you really have it. I've noticed in just my short time here. So hold on to that, use these mentors and learn from them and continue to carry that forward even when you do get your tenure track jobs at other institutions. If you can bring a piece of this TAMU warmth that I've felt already, you will do well. So my talk very much follows up with what Michael said, and I agree with everything he said. It said it a little bit differently, but definitely it's in the same vein. First of all, you might be thinking, why should we listen to a Canadian at all? And I don't blame you. That's probably a good thing. There are some Canadians down here in America that I wouldn't listen to, perhaps. But I was told not to make any political jokes, but I wanted to distance myself from some of the Canadians. But one thing that Canada does do is we often act as a bridge to Europe and to the former Commonwealth nations, because we have different interactions with these nations that America may not in the same way, and yet we're in North America. So if I can offer a vista from my place in Canada, I'd like to do so and take what you want to from it and ignore the rest, and we can talk about it during the question period and after. So. To situate myself, I come from a faculty where public intellectualism is written into our criteria document. I get credit for doing that work, and it's not service, it's scholarship. So just to let you know where I come from in my university. Not all universities in Canada are like that, but mine was founded, it broke away from another university in 1971. The ideals of the 60s were very strong. And we come from a very decentralized university where the dean of the faculty can make you a full professor alone. That all other committees are advisory to the dean. So in our faculty meetings, we have autonomy to do things that most universities don't. And ours, our criteria document means everything. We revised ours in 2014. If you're interested, I could show you this later, but it contains the call to action, the call to be a public intellectual, and the call to do participatory and action research. We still accept positivist research, don't get me wrong. We still count that. But it's kind of flipped around in our institution. What you would think, you got to kind of fight for gaining acceptance. For us, it's the positivists who are kind of on the back foot, and they have to really make a case for why we should accept what they're saying. So one of the things that I do, I make maps. I made this. It's probably the thing that I've made that has the most impact in my community. It's just a map of the city about where to get food, shelter, clothing, needle exchange, these community care. And there are over 20,000 of these in the community. And it's had an impact in so many ways. It's not just a map for those who need it, but it's actually a map for those who want to donate, for those who weren't aware. I use it, and many others in the community use it as a teaching tool, and we ask, is this your city? And most people say no, they don't recognize any of the places on it. And we use it as a tool to talk about awareness. And the other part that it's been used for is because, as you know, community-based organizations are often too busy just struggling to survive, just to stay open, to do the work that they're setting out to do, that they're not aware of the other institutions and community-based organizations all around in the same city. So it actually represented the first listing, comprehensive listing from a bird's eye view of what's available. And we noticed, for one thing, that there was no food on weekends, that all of them were giving food, but there was none on weekends. So some of the organizations changed that so that they could also offer food at times when the other ones weren't. And I get credit for this not just as service, but as academic work. It came out of a participatory action research with homeless people themselves, which I, in doing so, discovered that they don't consider themselves homeless. So I would ask, how long have you been homeless? And they would look at me like, we're not homeless. I go, okay, well, how long have you been using these services? Oh, 3 years, 4 years. You know what? It would be really useful if we had a map that talked about the hours and where to go to get certain foods and certain items. So we made one. I want to start by talking about the old and the new. I think we're all pretty aware that the paradigm wars seem quite distant to us. The challenges from the new millennium, sort of, how do we represent life? How do we say what's good or what's bad? Research the criteria for goodness. And how do we put these findings into action? We've kind of acknowledged them. They were met with judo as well as dance. New things are happening. Something that I never thought I'd ever say, I'd ever hear myself say, is we actually at our university have indigenous statistics courses. And you might think, how does that work? And I brought the actual course description. And basically, they acknowledge, all too often Western and First Nations research approaches are viewed as two presumably conflicting options for research methodology, quantitative or indigenous. In this case, they want to achieve an approach that has equal merit in both academic and First Nations settings. So great care is taken in terms of research design and ethics. So the actual statistics don't change, but how everything around them are built does change. And we take great care in that. So here's something that that blows my mind. I think, wow, we are at a time of methodological possibility. When I look around from my visit in Canada and around the world, I see a time of social justice, of community engagement, of participatory research, and decolonizing, place-based, and indigenous research. All of the things when you want to ask, what do you want? What is meaningful? What do you get out of graduate school experience? These are some of the things that you listed about engaging with the community and making a difference. The other part that I'm quite excited about is the alternative forms of research production, output, and dissemination. This is really changing. All of these and more continue to assert their inherent legitimacy in an academic landscape that is increasingly called upon future praxis and relationally oriented research outcomes. We're pushing boundaries and traditions. In at my institution and in institutions around Canada, we're really talking about what counts as an acceptable form and product or output of our scholarship. We contest and disrupt that it's journal articles and impact factors. We actively fight this. And like I said, in my own institution, we clearly list all kinds of things that count, including participatory plays and other acts of creative scholarship. And I wanted to show you one website. I'm not sure if you've seen this before, but the Community Engaged Scholarship for Health has a peer-reviewed sort of website that will peer review things that aren't journal articles. So they'll look at other products. They encourage the submission of a diverse array of products that result from health-related community-engaged work. Any product format will be considered, including but not limited to documents, live presentations, websites, online tools, videos. So the landscape is changing, and that's exciting. Another thing that I remember as a grad student being surprised to learn about was that it's actually not about evidence or no evidence, like Denzin reminded us in 2009. The politics and political economy of evidence is not a question of evidence or no evidence. It is rather a question of who has the power to control the definition of evidence, who defines the kinds of materials that count as evidence, who determines what methods best produce the best forms of evidence, and whose criteria and standards are used to evaluate the quality of evidence. So that's the good part. Now I kind of go into more sort of dovetailing with Michael's talk. Of course, universities are ever in flux as they shape and are shaped by societal change, and we're in a time of neoliberalism, new public management, and accountability. As we rush to deregulate the private sector, what people often goes unnoticed perhaps is that we hyper-regulated the public sector. So within the new public management, what has taken place is we overlaid market ideologies in public spaces that never used to have them, and they don't make sense. So we have market-based competition in higher education. We, as much as possible, want precarious employment. We want, you know, part-time, on-call, product-based, without any responsibility to them. So you see the erosion of tenure track jobs, of tenure itself in some places. And then what comes with it, when you overlay market ideologies on public institutions that were never meant to have these, you need something else. You need the accountability part. You start to over-surveil them. And that's where we are now, and that's the audit culture we are in and going towards. America's a bit different because of the very different ways you're funded. Canada's in between, and then we can look at some of the other countries that have a central funding system. If your funding is centrally organized and structured, it gives a lot of power to the state to then restructure your organization. So if we look around the world, by 2010, over a dozen countries have national performance-based research funding. That means that your funding is tied to how many publications you have, where they're published, what kinds of publication are they in top tier journals, and what kind of grants you're getting. So for instance, Australia, Belgium, Denmark, Finland, Hong Kong, Italy, New Zealand, Norway, Poland, Portugal, Spain, Sweden, and the United Kingdom all have this kind of system. And you might be wondering, well, you've listed a bunch of countries, you didn't tell me about America, and I didn't even see Canada on that list, why should we care? Well, universities start to resemble each other, and they do so by three basic operations. There's the coercive way. If I'm the funder and I tell you, I want you to do these things, then you do them, and that's the coercive type. But then there's also mimicry. Through mimetic processes, we want to mirror the universities we perceive to be doing well. And third, the normative isomorphism. We start to look like each other because we hang out with each other. We go to each other's conferences. We network with each other. We're in a web-based global university context so that we work with each other. And that gives me the hope part, though. Because we work with each other, we can maybe help change the context of what's happening. National and international rankings have a great course of effect as well, because we all want to mimic the top universities again. And we compete for students, student dollars, and all of the other academic capitalist models that Sheila Slaughter talks about. Just today in my email, I got this. This is from this morning at 5 in the morning. the university rankings, time to submit your data. Let's be part of this. So these things have a very course of effect because we try to mimic each other to get the best rankings. If I were to describe this, I'd say we have a new triple crisis, and it's of market, managerialism, and measurement. And of course, they all operate together. And basically, the subjugation of universities to neoliberal market ideologies means that academics, once conceptualized as partners, are being conditioned to reposition themselves as employees and auditable subjects, as our scholarship is measured against narrowly defined benchmarks. That's exactly what Michael said. From key performance indicators to audit culture, so how do we get there? The shift to audit culture occurs on a spectrum as the context moves from the nebulous publisher perish dictum, which as a graduate student I'm here, I'm sure you're feeling, I know I did, when we move towards a discipline and publish ultimatum. That is, audit culture is created when key performance indicators transition from being merely indicators, however poorly conceived, to becoming prescriptive, quantified benchmark and enforced targets and technologies of governance. So what's at stake? Loss of disciplinary and collegial autonomy and authority to assess what counts. Academic freedom itself is at risk because you're taking it away from the bodies that normally would have these internal debates about what counts or not. And what are the consequences? Well, it leads to safe research, to mainstream research, very short term. I like when you talked about the 10 and 15 year funding models, Karen. I thought that was exactly right. And it leads to a gamed economy, academy, where we're struggling to meet these indicators rather than doing what's real and what counts. All of a sudden, we don't do what matters, but we do what counts. And that's what's at stake. By way of, I thought this could lead to a bit of a conversation, so I was hoping to talk with you, and I didn't know exactly what you'd like to talk about as graduate students. But I put as an ideal type two different versions of the academy. One is the public university, and one is the market neoliberal university. So in a public university, the one that we imagine, the one of the ideal, it's a collegial atmosphere. It's about shared governance. In the neoliberal university, it's hierarchical, managerial, and autocratic. They tell you. A public university fosters community and curiosity-driven public interest research, and there's all kinds of variation in the kinds of output that are permitted and, in fact, even encouraged. Whereas in the market neoliberalized university, we're looking for applied research, market-driven, conventional, impact factor dominated, and where we're just looking at numbers, how many numbers and where did you publish them, the quantity. We can talk about things being at stake, for instance, the free generation and exchange of ideas, as opposed to private knowledge, intellectual property, things that are secretive and paywalled. The public university is collaborative, the market university is competitive, collectively oriented or entrepreneurial. Are we talking about an accessible serving students and citizens, or are we talking about financially inaccessible serving clients, income units, and customers? Is it properly funded? Is it independent? Or is it underfunded, compromised by corporate influence, fundraiser activities, or donor pressure? We see it as well in the hiring practices. Do you have a tenure and a strong permanent faculty, or is it precariously employed with sessionals and adjunct professors? The other part, I guess, to read the list is fair and equal pay or individualized reward systems, incentivized merit pay. Do we have a healthy skepticism with peer assessed accountability? Or is it surveillance-oriented, audited, and digital monitoring? And finally, how do we view productivity? Is it long-term, serving society, or is it narrowly framed and targeted? And I found that quite depressing, so I wanted to leave with something hopeful. And this one talks about history, but it's one I've always found very hopeful for me to think about, and that is that history is yours to make. It is not owned, but written by someone else for you to learn. History is not just the story you read, it's the one you write. It is the one you remember or denounce or relate to others. It is not predetermined. Every action, every decision, however small, is relevant to its course. History is filled with horror and replete with hope, and you shape the balance. And so as graduate students, when you take up these jobs, you have to remember what kind of place do you want to work in, what kind of impact do you want to have in your own societies, in your own communities. And this is really up to us. So I thought I'd end there, and we could have some time to talk. Yeah, come on up.